You're not the real Aaron.
Metro!
I'm the real Aaron.
Yeah. Drinking dope, turn me to a superhero. Hit that pill, turn me to a superhero.
What is going on, everybody? It's your boy Patrick. Today's video, I'm gonna run y'all through the holy grail of chest. We're gonna teach you how to grow your chest. Now, before we start, I just wanna make a quick disclaimer. If you have perfect chest insertions, this video is not for you because you're already genetically blessed, and I refuse to help you anymore, okay? This is only people that have a chest gap like I used to have. If you have one of those, stick around because I'm gonna teach y'all how to eventually make it come in a little bit more and just grow your chest overall with not favorable chest genetics. So sit back, relax, grab your next meal, and let's go. Okay, but before we get into the chest, I have to destroy my arms because y'all know we're still prioritizing arms. So let's roll the montage of the arm training and then let's go chest. All right, biceps are toasted. So now let's get into the chest work. We're gonna start with potato brain beginner stuff. We'll move to more advanced later in the video, just so everybody that's watching, no matter what level you're at, can gain good education from this and actually gain some type of value. All right, the age old question. What should you do first, pressing or flies? There's been some recent literature that's come out that says pre-exhaustion or doing flies before you're pressing could actually be detrimental to your chest growth. Me personally, taking my own personal anecdote and my experience, there's a couple reasons why I disagree with that. First, if you're someone that has very bad mind-muscle connection and you can't really connect well with your chest, like I did previously, I was very shoulder and tricep dominant. I would bench heavy, I would dumbbell press heavy, but for some reason, the weight I was moving didn't really correlate to a big chest for me. My shoulders and my triceps grew, but chest, not so much. So what did I start doing? I started implementing pre-exhaustion and doing my cable chest flies before any pressing movements. What this is gonna do is it's gonna allow you to actually connect well with your chest when you get onto the pressing, and it's gonna allow you to have a high degree of motor unit recruitment on the actual chest fly because you're doing it at the beginning of your workout. The reason why I don't really agree with the science that's coming out now saying that pre-exhaustion may actually inhibit your ability to recruit your chest is for reason number one, if you feel your chest more, and if you're starting with a chest cable fly, you're gonna have the highest degree of motor unit recruitment, like I mentioned. So that's gonna lead to chest growth. Number two, if that's the case, wouldn't we see the opposite where we see big ass bodybuilders fatiguing their triceps and fatiguing their delts early in their workout in order to make their pressing more chest bite? We don't see that. Everybody either starts with their pressing or they start with a fly. Would I say do pre-exhaustion forever? Would I say start every single workout with chest fly? Probably not. That's not what I've done. But I've periodically threw it in through different routines, through different training blocks, starting with the chest fly before moving on to my press. And I think that's gonna be very beneficial for someone who's struggling to recruit their chest and, you know, feel their chest on any chest movement. Sometimes when I go so hard, my brain will fry and I'll just like revert back to like NPC emotes like we just saw right there. All right, so another tip, don't assign certain exercises with certain rep ranges. This goes for any muscle group, but I see it very common with the chest and other pushing muscles, things like lateral raises, things like cable chest flies. People think that for some reason, a chest fly has to be trained between 12 to 15 reps plus. We know the most optimal range for hypertrophy is gonna be that 6 to 10 rep range, just because it's gonna limit fatigue while still getting us to push to failure and get those 5 effective reps, which is gonna be the 5 reps that are closest to failure. As you're gonna see today, we're going heavy on the chest fly. We're starting with it, we're going very heavy, gonna be somewhere in the 6 to 9 rep range. Just because it's a chest fly doesn't mean you have to train at 12, 15 reps plus, okay? Pick good exercises, Have good form and good execution with them. Don't change your execution when the weight creeps up and the rep ranges get lower, and you'll have no problem. Okay, another reason probably why your chest isn't growing the way you like is because you're not taking advantage of all the exercises, okay? One of my favorite exercises and the reason why we're starting when we're fresh with it is a seated cable fly. I don't see a lot of people doing this. I see people come in every single workout, they do their bench, then do a 4x12 on incline, then they do 3 sets of 15 burnout standing fly, and you wonder why your chest doesn't grow. But this exercise is a very stable movement, and it's a great way to fully isolate your chest and overload your chest in the short end position especially, with very few limiting factors. The only thing really that you're gonna fail on this is gonna be your chest, which is why it's gonna result in probably the best chest growth. But you just throw it in, you just go through the motions, get a little pump, and then you're done with chest. Actually putting chest flies like early in the workout and early in the session, really focusing and really trying hard on it is what I found to really blow my chest. Tip number two, what arm pass should you take, right? See guys really tucked, you see guys really flared. I'm gonna make it very simple and explain exactly when to use what type of arm path. So I would recommend on most exercises, the best arm path is gonna be the one where your elbow is tucked the most. Why? This is gonna allow you the deepest stretch on your pec, allowing you to train it in the biggest range of motion. You see a lot of people when they go to their incline dumbbell press and they have super flared out elbows. The reason for this is you're a lot stronger in that position. However, the only time that I would ever program elbows and arms very flared out is on a machine that converges. Why is that? Because we know our chest is responsible for adduction as well, right? However, when you're doing a dumbbell press, the only resistance is against gravity, which means the only resistance is going vertical, up and down. But when you have your elbows very flared, there's no resistance coming together in the adduction. When you're on a converging machine, there is resistance actually in the converging part because it's loaded as you converge, and as you press, the handles are coming together, giving you that adduction. So on this machine, the hammer strength, I would actually program more elbows flared, more guillotine style to allow you to hit those upper chest fibers. But other than a converging machine, anytime you're gonna super flare your elbows is really just to train your ego. Anything that is not a converging machine, elbows as tucked as possible. Any converging machine, you can benefit from having your elbows flared. Literal completely cold, man. Completely fucking cold. Okay, so the last thing that we're gonna cover here, exercise selection order. So now we know what exercises to pick, how to perform them. Now we need to know, what order should we actually put these exercises in our routine, in our training day? This is not that important of a tip. It's really only gonna make a tiny difference. So I wouldn't really worry about this unless you're more of an advanced to expert level, because the main priority for every single exercise is gonna be getting stronger week to week and actually pushing more weight without having our technique and our execution change. That is mainly what is gonna result in the most growth possible. But if you are in an advanced level and you wanna squeak out every little 1% difference you can, this is what I would recommend for how to organize the exercises in your push day. The exercises that we want first in our push day are gonna be exercises that are heavily loaded in the shortened position. If you're trying to figure out between shortened and lengthened position and which part is loaded, is it the lengthened position that's loaded or is it the shortened position that's loaded? I would say do an exercise and look at where you fail. Where is the heaviest of the exercise? So if the heaviest part and the hardest part, the part that you fail at the most, is actually at the lockout, the end range of motion, that means that the machine is loaded in the shortened position. If majority of the time you're failing at the bottom, so at the full strength in the lengthened position, that means the exercise is loaded in the lengthened position. Just two examples I can think of. So for a shortened position movement, I would honestly say any converging hammer strength press that is gonna be loaded very heavily in the short. Most people are gonna fail at that lockout, that last 20% being the hardest, or something like a cable fly or a cable press, right? The bottom is fairly easy, but once you get to the top, once you get to that lockout, that last 20% is when most people fail and they can't really finish that rep. So what I would do is I would always prioritize movements that are loaded in the shortened position first. Why would we do this? Because basically, in the beginning of your workout, when you're fresh, you're gonna have the highest available motor unit recruitment to use on your exercise. So if we have our shortened position movements first, that means we're gonna get that extra push and that extra oomph when we're fully locked in, fully fresh at the beginning of the workout, to give us that extra ability to stay on top of the rep and really squeeze out those final reps in the shorter position where it gets harder. So after that is when I would have things that are more lengthened loaded, things like, you know, cable lateral raises, Smith machine press, things that you're gonna fail at the bottom portion. I would have that later in the workout because you don't really need that oomph for that push to finish off the reps in the beginning. All right, that's pretty much gonna wrap it up for this video. If you follow all these tips, it's pretty much impossible that you won't get a bigger chest. Now, obviously, like I had the chest gap here, it's obviously improved. Is it ever gonna be fully connected? No, that's just genetics, that's just how the muscle inserts. But if you do get a bigger chest, you can actually slightly bring your chest in bigger, reduce that gap, and then have big old juicy double D's. If you did enjoy the video, please leave a like rating, subscribe if you are new, because I have tons of videos like this. I have one for legs, I have one for back, now one for chest. I'm gonna do every single muscle group, cover it just so that you guys are fully covered in all your bases. But that's it for this one. I'll catch you in the next one. Peace.